Hello world, this is Sean Wilkinson of the University of Alabama at Birmingham. This screencast demonstrates QMachine, a web service that allows you to use ordinary web browsers to execute distributed workflows without installing anything. Now you'll notice that the web page that I have opened is not QMachine.org. That's because I'm demonstrating in this video that you don't need to use QMachine.org directly in order to use QMachine. You can embed QMachine's analytical layer directly into your web page, wherever your web page happens to be hosted. This web page is hosted at googlecode.com inside of a Mercurial repository, and that's why you see this really long URL. It's referring to an exact version inside of the repository so that you can reproduce this experiment exactly. So let's follow along. Click the button below to launch the demonstrations. Click, and the demonstrations are launched. Volunteer for FASTA demo here. I'll return to that. QMachine will print the results into the developer's console. So we need to open a developer's console. Every modern browser has one of these. They're here because normally people want to make pretty web pages, and so they need to be able to debug the pages. We're going to use it like an interactive development environment, like R or MATLAB. And so let's go ahead and show. I have four volunteers already opened in a different machine to speed up this process. So I'm going to show how to volunteer for FASTA demo as was specified on the page we started on. What you do is you load v1.qmachine.org and you need to specify a box and then click. When you click, your browser will start executing jobs that you just put in. FASTA demo is the queue name. The reason I called it a box instead of a queue is basically because QMachine had too many queues floating around anyway and it was getting confusing. So I called it a box. When we return back to the original page, you see that when we had clicked the button and it loaded a demo script, the code for the demo script can be found in this repository as well as an archive version of the original data. So now I'll show you what the code is. The code, which unfortunately Google Code's headers do not allow you to look directly at the code in the browser in a nice pretty way. For some reason it downloads to your local computer, but I'll go ahead and show you. In the report, QMachine Commodity Supercomputing with Web Browsers, we showed in the results section four demonstrations that illustrate use cases from simple algebraic operations all the way up to real-world genomic analysis. For this first example, we're going to take the number 2 and we're going to add 2 to it. We're going to get 4. That part's obvious, but it demonstrates, the main interesting part about that demonstration, as shown here, is that we're running it, we're expressing the demonstration in CoffeeScript, but it will run in JavaScript. QMachine is capable of running JavaScript on other machines, and you can express in whatever you like so long as you can translate it into JavaScript. For example 2, we're going to use a map function, which is going to take an array 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and we're going to apply the same increment by 2 operation as we did in the example 1, but we're going to apply it to each element of the array because that's what a map function does. So instead of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, we expect to see 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. The puts function in both cases will make it appear here in the developer console of the invoking submitting machine, even though the computations will happen and be entirely resolved on a volunteer machine in another, perhaps another physical context, maybe just another tab. But the computational nodes are one-to-one correspondence with other tabs. So the third example will be the MapReduce, which is like a map. It will take this first transform and apply it element-wise to each element of this array, which we will end up then with 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. And then it's going to take pairs of the elements and add them together repeatedly until we get a single number, and that's what it's going to return. And then the puts function is going to print it out. Both the map function and the reduce function that it's going to use here are distributed across other machines. And by the way, because 2 plus 2 is 4, and we all know that, but it still hasn't returned over here, it bears mentioning that these jobs don't necessarily run in the order in which they were invoked. Example 4 is significantly more interesting, actually. It's the real-world example for sequence analysis. What we're going to do is we're going to take an array X of URLs that are that point to FASTA files hosted by NCBI for Streptococcus pneumonia. We have 20 different strains here represented. what we're going to do is pass the URLs to the remote volunteer workers, and they're going to download the file and thereby parallelize the bandwidth as well as the computation. We're going to do this processing each element separately by using a map function that you see down here. And in the end, we're going to print the result back in the Submitter Machine's developer console. So the function f that we're going to apply to each element in this array is going to take a URL and feed it into the USM library, which is the Universal Sequence Maps library by Jonas Almeida. And it's going to align the genome after it retrieves the URL. It's going to align the genome with this sequence here. We're going to find this needle in a haystack. Meanwhile, we finally found out what 2 plus 2 is. It is 4, in fact, so we are living well. You'll notice, however, that USM is part of a library. It's not part of standard JavaScript. You can't expect a remote browser to already have loaded the USM library. So what we're going to have to do is specify that the USM library be loaded before the computation occurs. Otherwise, the computation is just going to fail. So we have an env object for that purpose that helps to prepare the environment for the computation beforehand. USM here specifies an array of prerequisites so that these libraries can be loaded before the computation runs. USM library is going to come off GitHub right here, and prior to that, we're going to load the JMAT library from the Google Code repository. I've also listed in the comments here the short URLs that I used in the report, so that, just for continuity's sake. And meanwhile, of course, we see that the example 2 has come back, and example 3. That's quite nice. So let's go see what's been occurring this whole time in our volunteers. Well, in our volunteers, actually, they're quite boring now. They're actually almost dormant. On my other machine, there are still 3 jobs remaining, but I'll go ahead and talk you through this. So first, for the sequence alignment things, JMAT's going to load, then CGR Toolbox, which is actually the USM library. CGR stands for Chaos Game Representation. Then it's going to use its own functions from the CGR library to retrieve the FASTA file from the NCBI repository. Once it has those, it's going to perform a fractal MapReduce decomposition of the Chaos Game representation in order to find that needle in a haystack. The haystacks themselves for Streptococcus pneumonia are approximately 2.5 million base pairs in length, so this isn't a trivial computation. Ultimately, it will return, after it maps through these things, it will return the largest identical segment and the alignment for the base sequence and the probe sequence. It's going to return that object to the original machine that invoked, and here we are. We have, unfortunately, these objects, due to the way that JavaScript stringifies objects, these are basically unreadable. So I'm going to show you also, I'm going to take this opportunity to show you how QMachine is actually using the API server to communicate. What it's doing is, when you see these things done, this is actually a key that you can go to, and you're going to go to FASTA demo, because that's the box, and we're going to go look at this particular key. That shows you the actual datum, as it were, that was used for the computation. You can see that the status is now done, but prior to that it was waiting, running, and could have failed. Thankfully it didn't. For F and X, we also have more keys that we can then point to, and we see here's the position of the base, the position of the probe, and the match, as promised, so that if you were programming this directly instead of printing it out, you would have seen these things and would be able to manipulate these as part of a workflow. The way that QMachine's API server actually provides the queues is by checking for the status, where you see that an array, as shown in table 1 of the report, an array is returned. So let's see things that are running, for example. Well, we have quite a lot of things that are running, and if we looked at any particular one of these tasks, we would see something very similar to what we saw before, where we have a box, a key, a val, fx, and a status that's running, and that's really it. That's QMachine, and I appreciate. Thank you for thanks for watching.